Oh yeah, book versus tax income. Here we go. This is Joey from Universal CPA Review, and we're going to talk a little bit about Schedule M1 and M3 reconciliations. Keep in mind, these reconciliations are conceptually similar to what you would see when reconciling bank statements to the books in the FAR exam, only we're talking about something completely different. All right, so we now need to know the differences in what is considered a temporary difference versus a permanent difference. Is this going to impact the tax return or the financial statements? Okay, so before we dive into it, I'm slightly obligated to tell you and also encourage you not to forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Also, join any of our Facebook groups. You can find the link to those in the description of this video. And if you feel as though you're more of a visual learner, Universal CPA Review might be for you. We also have video explanations on every single multiple choice question and every single task-based simulation. If you think Universal CPA Review might be worth your time, give it a try for free. And if you want to join our program in a more permanent way, feel free to use discount code UNIVERSAL2021 at the checkout for 25% off any Universal CPA Review product. Okay, book to tax income, let's go, I'm psyched. Okay, let's dig into it. We're talking about the differences between book and tax income. And this is an area that can be somewhat challenging, especially for those of you who haven't sat for the FAR exam yet. And maybe you did take FAR, but this is still an area that trips you up. Okay, so let's get back to the basics for a second and understand what's actually happening here, because this is very important when it comes to filing entity tax returns, right? At the end of the day, these corporations are taking the books prepared by Sinbad, the company's bookkeeper, and this is being reconciled or compared to the taxable income computed when filing the company's tax return with the IRS. Okay, so as you've noticed at this point, there are a lot of items that might be considered includable versus excludable when calculating taxable income. There are a lot of items that are considered deductible versus non-deductible when calculating taxable income. But that doesn't necessarily mean that when preparing the books, they were not recorded as an expense or as revenue. So there can very often be these discrepancies in what was recorded in the books versus what was recorded in the tax return. Right? In the same way that when reporting financial statements, it's important to do a bank statement to book reconciliation when calculating the cash line item in the balance sheet. Okay, so for those of you who've already taken a lap through the FAR exam, that might sound familiar. We're essentially doing the same thing, only now we're going to be reconciling what was reported in the tax return versus what was reported in the same books. Okay, so these reconciliations will be filed on Schedule M1 and Schedule M3. These are our two schedules on the tax side. They need to be prepared when performing this reconciliation. Okay, so don't get spooked by the terms M1 and M3. At this point, it doesn't seem like the exam cares too much about the differentiation of these schedules. Okay, so what you need to know is that all companies will generally be required to file this Schedule M1. Okay, so as you can see, this is a very basic form, and it is the minimum requirement for corporations with $10 million in assets or less. Okay, and if they have $10 million or more, then they're still going to be required to file this Schedule M1. Okay, but the company will also be required to file Schedule M3. Okay, and that's going to be more of a robust breakout of what is considered a temporary difference and a permanent difference. And we'll talk about that more in just a second. All right, so think of Schedule M3 as sort of this additional disclosure to Schedule M1 if the company has $10 million in assets or more. All right, and again, that's going to be a breakout of the discrepancies or these differences. Okay, so when you see a question of either of these, it's more or less going to be asking the same thing. Might be some small differences in the wording of the question, like if this is an M3 adjustment, what would the company disclose as temporary versus permanent differences? Okay, but as we said, at the end of the day, they're really just trying to focus your attention on the impacts to temporary versus permanent differences and your overall ability to calculate this reconciliation. Okay, so now this is where the module gets a little bit more important. We're really going to break out the differences in what is considered a temporary versus permanent difference. So we have this list of differences, some being temporary and some being permanent. Okay, so you need to do your best not to memorize this list, no matter how tempting it might seem. Because if you're memorizing a bunch of words, it's only going to be a lot more challenging when you see this on a task-based simulation if you do. Okay, so we really need to dissect what is what. So again, we need to understand the intuition and ask ourselves, why does this make sense? Where did I see this before? Okay, because the reality is, a lot of this stuff is stuff that we've already gone through. Okay, so we've got installment sales. Installment sales is when payments are made in installments. Okay, so this is going to be recognized on the tax return when cash is received. Okay, but it's going to be recognized at some point. So it is going to be considered a temporary difference. Anytime you see something received in advance, we need to note that we're going to recognize this when the cash has been received on the tax return, but not until it has been earned in the financial statements. Okay, so rents received in advance and royalties received in advance. For those reasons, that's why this would be recognized as a temporary difference. Dividends under the equity method. All right, so under US GAAP, this is going to be considered income in the subsidiary's earnings. Whereas on the tax return, this is going to be income that is recognized in its entirety when the dividend has been received. All right, so how about bad debt expense? Bad debt expense is going to be reported under the allowance method. Okay, so therefore we're going to project this based on a percentage of ending balances of accounts receivable. Whereas on the tax return, we're going to apply the direct write-off method. It's eventually going to be recognized, so that's why it's a temporary difference. The estimated liability for contingencies. All right, so we're going to accrue this as an expense in the financial statements, but because it's an accrual, we're not going to deduct it until the cash has been paid on this liability. All right, so how about interest expenses on business loans? All right, so this is going to be recorded as an expense, but we're only going to be able to deduct this up to a limitation. All right, so it's going to be expensed on the financial statements in its entirety, but the amount that we can deduct will be limited. How about charitable contributions? So this can be a temporary difference. It can also be a permanent difference. Basically, we need to identify if there is a limitation and if the amount that is contributed exceeds that limitation. On the financial statements, we can take the entire charitable contribution as an expense. However, if we remember, we're only going to be limited to 10% of the corporation's taxable income as a deduction on the tax return. All right, so there's going to be that discrepancy. It might carry over into the future, in which case this is going to be a discrepancy that reverses, making it temporary. But if some of this charitable contribution is not going to be deductible in the future, then it would be a permanent difference, right? Maybe we run out of carryover runway and we don't have anything left to offset this by. All right, depreciation is a huge one. All right, so it depends on if we're applying a certain type of depreciation on the tax return versus another type of depreciation in the financial statements. Right, if we're taking a straight line on the tax return and we're taking an accelerated method of depreciation in the financial statements, we're going to be taking more of a depreciation expense in the financial statements than the tax return. All right, now keep in mind, this is eventually going to be depreciated in its entirety. Okay, so therefore that difference today will eventually reverse. So how about Section 179 depreciation? This is going to be limited to just over $1 million in the tax return. All right, but we need to depreciate the asset on the financial statements. Amortization for startup and organizational costs. What do we remember about this? Well, on the tax return, we're going to take $5,000 off the first year, and then we're going to amortize the remaining portion of the expenses over 15 years. Okay, so we can expense this in the financial statements. Eventually, it's all going to be deducted and all expensed, so therefore that difference is temporary. Franchise costs are going to have a little bit of a difference when it comes to the amortization. Okay, so on the tax return, we gotta remember, we're gonna be amortizing this over 15 years. Okay, so goodwill also going to be a little bit different. On the tax return, we're going to amortize this over 15 years. In the books, we're going to provide an impairment test. Depletion might also have a temporary discrepancy. Okay, so how about pension expenses? These are going to be deducted when paid on the tax return. However, we're going to accrue the expense in the financial statements. So it's still going to be accrued and therefore it's going to be recognized, but we're not going to record this as a deduction on the tax return until it is paid. Okay, and same goes for all accrued expenses, right? The definition is this is an expense that is recorded because it has been accrued, but it has not yet been paid. Okay, so we're recording this as an expense in the financial statements, but we're not going to deduct it in the tax return until it has been paid. Okay, and finally, we have our capital losses and our net operating losses. We also have our carrybacks and our carryovers. As we remember, capital losses are not deductible on the corporate tax return. All right, but they are going to be reported as a loss on the income statement. And same goes for net operating losses. All right, whew, that was a long list. Thinking about the permanent differences. This is a difference between the tax return and the financial statements that will never reverse. Okay, so a great example of this is going to be state and local interest income. Right, this is interest income from our state and local municipal bonds. We remember, this is never going to be included as interest income. All right, and that's going to be for tax purposes. It's still going to be included in the financial statements as income. Right, we're just going to put this on the income statement as interest income. With that being said, because we're never going to recognize it on the tax return, that would mean that this would be a permanent difference. They love to test this. Dividends received deduction. There's no such thing in the financial statements, but we could take a dividends received deduction in the tax return, right? So life insurance proceeds, not going to be included on the tax return. We're going to record it in the financial statements. We briefly touched on charitable contributions. If we can't carry over our future contributions, then this is not going to eventually reverse. Okay, so in that situation, it would be permanent. Okay, so life insurance expenses. This is not going to be deductible on the tax return, but will be recorded as an expense in the financial statements. Penalties and fines, all right? So penalties and fines never going to be deductible. However, we're going to be able to take this as an expense in the financial statements. Same goes for entertainment and lobbying and political expenses. Not deductible in the tax return, but will be reported in the financial statements, right? So once upon a time, entertainment used to be deductible up to 50%. No longer going to be the case per TCJA. Federal income taxes, not going to be deductible, but we could take this as an expense in the income statement, right? So that's going to be a permanent difference because we're never going to deduct federal income taxes. All right, so at the end of the day, I would recommend starting with understanding the permanent differences. This is a little bit more intuitive. And when we zero in on our key differences to focus on, tax-exempt items and non-deductible items at this point should be somewhat of a familiar language to you. We know that state and local interest income is never going to be taxed, right? We know that generally life insurance proceeds will not be included. Okay, so take a step back and think about non-deductible items, penalties, lobbying, and political expenses. We know that these are never going to be deductible. Therefore, this difference will be permanent. And the temporary differences that they love to test can be things like depreciation. Always think the difference between straight line on one and accelerated depreciation on the other. Eventually, it will get depreciated over time, which makes this temporary. Same goes for prepaid expenses and income received in advance. When cash is paid or cash is received, we're going to recognize this in its entirety when received or paid on the tax return, but we're not going to recognize this in the financial statements until it has been earned or has been incurred. All right, so let's simplify, people. Let's go through a quick example. Okay, people, the time has come. We're talking about Aging Equipment Inc., and they have the following information in the current year. It looks like they have assets that are depreciable fixed assets that are valued at $1 million. We also know that the asset has an estimated useful life of 10 years. Okay, so we also know that the company has financial statement income of $200,000. Is that the amount that we're going to use to calculate our tax liability? No, it is not. This is net income on the income statement. Okay, so let's continue reading. We see that included in the financial statement income amount is $10,000 from interest from state and local bonds. We also know that the company depreciated equipment for tax purposes by applying the straight line method. They also applied the double declining balance method for book purposes. So we want to know what amount would be reported as taxable income in the current year. All right, so when we're thinking about taxable income, this is going to be the amount after adjustments have been made. So these are going to be adjustments made from temporary and permanent differences. All right, so temporary differences are going to be timing differences. These are going to reverse, whereas permanent differences will never reverse. So if we think about some of the key items that they love to test, we know that depreciation and tax-exempt items are going to very often be included in the book versus tax reconciliation. Okay, so let's start by looking at depreciation. We know that the asset applies straight line when calculating the taxable income amount. We know that the asset's valued at $1 million and has an estimated useful life of 10 years. So if it's applying straight line, the depreciation expense would just be 1 million divided by 10. That's a $100,000 depreciation expense. We also know that in the income statement, we're going to be taking depreciation expense by applying the double declining balance method, which is an accelerated method of depreciation. All right, so this is more of a FAR calculation, and maybe they give you just the amount that is depreciated for book purposes on the exam. But also maybe they don't, right? Maybe you get a more complicated task-based simulation that requires that you understand this calculation. All right, so the double declining balance method will take the straight line percentage, which we know is 10%, and we're going to double it. Okay, so we're going to take 20%, multiply it by the $1 million asset, and we're going to accelerate $200,000 worth of depreciation in earlier years in the books. So what does that mean? It means that when we're calculating our $200,000 net income amount, we took a $200,000 depreciation expense when getting there. All right. So we also know that we took a $100,000 depreciation expense when calculating taxable income. So that discrepancy amounts to $100,000. And that's a temporary difference. Okay, so we know that it's temporary because eventually this $1 million asset is going to be depreciated down to zero. All right, we're only accelerating that depreciation in the books, and we're taking straight line, which is a slower method of depreciation, in the tax return. All right, so what else do we know we have? We know that of this $200,000 amount, $10,000 is going to be from state and local interest income. All right, so $10,000 is included in this calculation. But what do we know about state and local interest income when it comes to calculating taxable income? We know that interest from state and local bonds is never going to be included. All right, so that's what makes this a permanent difference. All right, so it's never going to reverse. At the end of the day, they want us to calculate taxable income. So what is gross income on the income statement? Well, we know that the net income amount is $200,000. We know that we included $10,000 and depreciated $200,000 when getting there. So we're going to add $200,000 back to the total amount, and we're going to subtract $10,000 back from that $200,000 total amount to give us gross income of $390,000. Okay, so that gross income amount is going to be the same amount as our top line gross income on the tax return. Only now we're not going to include this $10,000 from state and local interest income, and we're only going to take a $100,000 depreciation expense. Okay, so taxable income would be $290,000. All right, so we got to remember, at the end of the day, this is all about knowing the key differences in what is a temporary difference versus a permanent difference when reconciling the tax return to the books.